So today it is a very important topic. So that is about humility. And we're going to read this text 3. So I hope everyone remember that we have completed the text 2 and we are going into text 3. Any doubts? All clear that we are into text 3?
Yes, Prabhu.
Okay, great. So what we'll do is we'll try to recite the text 3 together, line by line. Okay, we'll do it together. Trinadapi suni chena.
Trinadapi suchena.
Taroriva sahishnuna.
Taroriva sahishnuna.
Amani naman dena.
Amani naman dena.
Kirtaniya sada harihi.
Kirtaniya sada harihi.
Can someone read the translation?
Prabhuji, can I?
Okay, Mataji, lead us with the translation, word by word.
Okay, Prabhuji. who is more tolerant than a tree, but is always prepared to give all respect to others. Can very easily. Always chant
the holy name of the Lord.
Thank you, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna. So, if we see the text 2, that has been ended. Okay, whoever is not talking, please be on mute. Okay. So, if we see the text 2, it ends with the misfortune that I don't have the taste. Durdaiva midrisham iha jani nanuragaha. And if we see the third text, it ends with the, you know, kirtaniya sadahari. That means in the second, it ended with I am misfortune. And then third text is ending with how we can become the fortunate, how we can have taste for chanting the holy name consistently, you know, kirtaniya sadahari. So when we talk about kirtaniya, it may not necessarily always mean we are chanting the holy name completely, but it can also be like we are glorifying the Lord. So kirtana means also glorification. So when we say kirtaniya sadahari, that means we are completely absorbed in Krishna. So we will talk about the qualities like humility and tolerance, which generally comes in this text. So we'll not be able to cover the both topics, humility and tolerance. So today we will take care about this humility. So we will see the meaning and cultivation of that quality, both from the scriptural perspective and from the practical perspective. So if we go back to 13.8, where Krishna would be talking about the 20 things of knowledge. Okay, so I'll just share the screen. So here Krishna talks about amanitvam adambhitvam. So here Prabhupada translates these two words as humility and pridelessness. So these two words are going to play a major role in understanding this particular verse. So we have to, you know, we know many definitions for humility. Each one of us might have different perspective about what humility is. But today we'll have a foundation based on what Prabhupada has given the definition. So what Prabhupada has said, that humility means that one should not be anxious to have the satisfaction of being honored by others. So it is a very striking definition. I'll read it again. Humility means that one should not be anxious to have the satisfaction of being honored by others. So here Prabhupada is not saying that we should not get honored. Okay, so humility doesn't mean that you will not get honor or you should reject the honor. But here we are not anxious about it. So to understand this, we'll try to understand 4 different words. That is mana, amanitvam, and dambha and adambitvam. Okay, so mana means I have certain qualities which are honorable, okay, and I want respect for those qualities. So this is mana. So you have qualities and you want respect. So when respect is given for the qualities that you have, that is called mana. Okay. And then the next is amanitvam. Amanitvam means you have the qualities that are honorable, but you don't crave for the respect. So if it is coming, you don't reject it. But if it is not coming also, you're not going around to get that. So for example, if you are rich, okay, so you are rich, you are wealthy, but you don't expect people to treat you as a wealthy man whenever they meet you. You don't want them to give you respect as a wealthy man. If they give, that is okay. If not also, you're not craving for it. So this is mana and amanitva. Now, dambha means you don't have the quality that is to be honored, okay, but still you pretend to be. So for example, there is a boy, okay, so he want to impress a girl. So what he does, he takes some of the wealthiest friend's car and he claims that it is his car and he goes to impress her girl. And the girl says, oh, this car belongs to you, you own it. Okay, I'll be coming with you. So what he is doing is, he is trying to impress by taking something which he doesn't belong to him. That means he doesn't have the quality to be honored, but still he's pretending that I have a quality. That means he is not a rich person, but he's pretending to get the respect. So this is called dambha. So adambitva means you're not exhibiting this quality. So here, in general, if we talk about humility in this normal materialistic world, often people say like humility, they relate with low self-esteem or inferiority complex or self-demeaning. So sometimes it is also considered as a weakness also. So people might say like, why you have to be humble? You know, you have to have a self-esteem. You have to be aggressive and all. So, but the actual meaning is not that. You know, it is not a weakness. It is actually one of the greatest strength that one can have. So when we go back to the definition, Prabhupada is saying that, you know, being honored by others, actually in our Vaishnava culture, if we see here, most of us are not eligible to talk anything on the spirituality or anything about these such exalted qualities. But still, we get respect because in our Vaishnava culture, whenever we meet someone, okay, we bow down to them, we fold our hands, we try to respect each other. So though the qualities and all, whatever we have, most of the times we don't consider because in our Vaishnava culture, we say everyone as a Prabhu and Mataji because we give them the highest respect. So when we are talking about humility, sometimes it becomes very difficult. You know, in a Vaishnava culture, even when you don't have the qualities, still you'll get honored for that sometimes. Because people consider you as a part and parcel of Krishna and they see Krishna in you. So here it has become very difficult to, you know, maintain humility because people are giving you the respect and honor. And sometimes this may relate to pride. So here what is happening is Prabhupada is saying like if someone is giving the respect, that is fine. But you should not be craving for it. Like we are not going to every person to expecting that, okay, you know, you have to give me the honor, you have to respect me and all. But if someone is giving, that is okay. Now, let's go move on to taking about example of Srila Prabhupada. When he was in India, so in India, you know, those times it was very pious, unlike today. So when a sadhu is coming, people generally do respect them, right? Because sadhu is considered as one who has devoted his life to the Lord and he is sacrificing so many things. So people generally give the respect. But when Prabhupada moved to US, as Prabhuji was telling, in the areas like Bowery and all, where they have no knowledge about how to treat a sadhu, okay, how to give respect and all. But still, Prabhupada continued. Prabhupada didn't thought like, you know, these people are not respecting me, so I will not preach. Because he had a purpose. He wanted to preach the mission of Lord Chaitanya. He wanted to execute the order of his Guru Maharaj of preaching into the West. So here we will understand what the humility, another definition of humility like, we will not our ego come in between our purpose. That means Prabhupada's purpose was preaching and his ego might have said that, you know, people are not respecting me, but he has not let that ego come in between his purpose. So one of the best definition for the humility is like, we are not letting our ego interfere with our purpose. So then we move on to understand about how we have to control this. Now, if you are a book distributor, okay, in general, when we devotees meet together about book distribution and all, so if someone has performed well, you know, so what we will do, we will honor them, right? We will appreciate them, isn't it? But the same book distributor, when he goes on the next day, Do you think he will get the same respect in the market? No, right? But still he has to continue because he is not doing this service to get the honor or respect. He is doing this service for the Krishna. So the intention is not whether I will get respect or not, but the intention is whether I will be able to serve Krishna properly or not. So a service is not conditioned with the respect. Whether respect comes or not, that is not the condition based on which I will do the service. I will just go and try to give my best. If someone respects me, someone honors me, that is okay. But my sole purpose is not for that. So here what is happening is we are going beyond ourselves. Now, we will try to understand this concept of humility in three aspects. Okay. So one is with respect to the service, as I discussed now. And second is with respect to the self. And third is with respect to Krishna. So when we talk about Srila Prabhupada example or this book distribution example, here we can clearly say that, you know, the person is going beyond his own self-conscious attitude and he is trying to serve. So here what is happening is service is not depend on what is coming in return. Service is depending on only thought like what I am giving. Okay. So most of the times in the material world, what happens is maybe we have seen in our corporate world also, we don't perform or we don't do some extra thing for the benefit of the company because we know that even if I do, no one is going to acknowledge that. No one is going to appreciate that. In the time of appraisal, definitely they will say company is not performing. So why I have to work extra? So let me do only what I can do for this much because they are paying me this much. Let me work to that only. So in the material world, the motive is more about, you know, what I'm going to get in return. But when we talk about spiritual service, it is not like, because we know that Krishna is there as in heart, as Paramatma, always watching each of everyone of activity. So he gonna see us and he gonna appreciate us and he gonna acknowledge us. So let us do the service for Krishna. So here we are very humble because we know that we are not doing for someone else or for us. We are trying to do it for Krishna. So when I'm trying to do for Krishna, so let me do it as a best. Whether some respect is coming or not coming, it is okay. Because sometimes what happens is if we are preaching, sometimes we might go to an environment or to a particular set of people where they may not be receptive for the spiritual knowledge. So when we are sharing something, there should be some respect to each other. Let us say, at least you being silent, you actually paying the respect. You are trying to listen to me, right? But if you are in a very challenging mood, you are just waiting for a chance to challenge me that, you know, how can you say like that? Just prove me this and all. So in such an environment, what happens is generally the preacher will not get the respect. Okay. And there might be some other environments where people are very eager to listen to you and they are very much receptive for the spiritual knowledge. They are very much receptive to Krishna consciousness. That time, whatever you speak, you might get well reception and people might honor you. People might respect you. So a preacher won't decide that, you know, here I'm not getting respect, so I will not go. Here I'm getting a lot of respect, so I will go. Or in another way, he might think, oh, these people are giving me so much respect and appreciation. And because of that, I may develop pride. So what I'll do is I'll not go there. I'll go to this place where I'm not getting respect because by going there, I can become humble. So both are misapplication. So it is not like, you know, you will decide where you want to go and preach just like that. If the authority says that you have to preach in this particular area, then you will do it. Because you're not letting this respect come in between you and the instruction of the authority. So this one is something about related to service. Now, humility talking about with respect to self. Most of the times we feel like self-pity is humility. You know, we might hear many people saying, you know, I'm so fallen. I'm so, you know, I can't do anything. There are so many things who are better than me. I'm good at nothing and all. Now, this is not humility. Now, this may sound like a humility, but this is not humility. See, here what is happening is, now if someone comes to you and tells that, you know, I have done this thing, I have achieved this thing, you know, I single-handedly have solved so many things. So when someone is talking like this, what you will feel?
He or she are boasting.
Yeah, like he is very proud of what he is doing, right? So self-pride is there. But actually, when someone says that, you know, I am good for nothing, I am doing nothing, there are many people who are doing a lot of things, and I am so fallen and all. So in this both cases, the person is absorbed in himself only. When he is boasting about himself, when he is talking less about himself, he is there with him only. So he is not coming out of his own consciousness. So in one way, when someone is boasting, we can call it as self-congratulatory mode. So he's not expecting others to say something. He himself is saying so many things. And when someone is talking about very less about something, his own self, then he is into self-condemning mode. So whether it is self-congratulatory or self-condemning, both are related to self-absorption only. There is no absorption in Krishna. So when we talk about humility, it is about absorption in Krishna. That means we are coming out of ourself and getting absorbed into Krishna. So when Srila Prabhupada was there in the US, so he was not talking about his achievement or his struggle anytime. He will be mostly talking about how Krishna is glorified. You know, how Krishna is helping us so many ways and how we have to devote ourselves to Krishna. So he was always glorifying Krishna. He was not glorifying himself. So though he has went through the struggle, he was not talking about his struggle. He was talking about Krishna. So here, when we are self-absorbed, either we'll talk so many good things about us or so many bad things about us. But always we are talking about us only. But when we are absorbed in Krishna, we are actually glorifying. So if we want to check whether we are humble or not, so we have to see whether we are absorbed in self or in Krishna. So if we are absorbed in self, whether by boosting or by condemning ourselves, that doesn't mean that we are humble. So we have to be humble, and our actions should be in glorifying the Krishna. So Krishna's greatness has to be broadcasted, not our smallness. Okay, so I'll repeat, Krishna's glories has to be broadcasted. Krishna's greatness has to be broadcasted, not our smallness. However small we are, Krishna with us. So there is no point in talking how low or how fallen we are. Because when I say, I am so fallen, the focus is not on the fallen. The focus is on I am. So that is the reason we cannot become humble and we get struck into this. And when we talk about exalted devotees, like, you know, in Srila Krishnadas Kaviraja Goswami, he says, I am most fallen than Jagai and Madai. And I am most fallen than a worm in the stool. So when exalted devotees say like this, you know, I think you have heard about this story of Jagai and Madai. They are most sinful, right?
Yes.
Okay, so someday we will talk about this story. Okay, so these Jagai and Madai are the... Prabhuji, if I am not wrong, they are the Jay and Vijay?
Yes, Prabhu.
Yeah, so the Hiranyakashipu, Hiranyaksha in Satya Yuga, and Ravana, Kumbhakarna, and the Shishupala and Dantavakra are the Jagai and Madai in the Chaitanya Leela. Okay, so these two are very fallen. Okay, so many crimes they have done. But then, with the mercy of Sri Nityananda Prabhu and Lord Chaitanya, they become the devotees, Jagadananda and Magadananda. Okay, so Srila Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami, who is the author of Chaitanya Charitamrita, right? He is one of the exalted devotee of Lord Chaitanya. He says that I am most fallen than Jagai and Madai. Now, when we hear this, we get, you know, shocked, like how they can say that they are fallen than Jagai and Madai. Because we are better than Jagai and Madai, we consider ourselves. So how an exalted devotee can say like that? So here, the exalted devotees are so much absorbed in Krishna that, you know, they see what Krishna has done to me. And they will feel like the same mercy and the same blessing, if this would have been received by Jagai and Madai, then they would have been exalted more than me. So they see in this way. That is the reason they say that I am fallen more than Jagai and Madai. So we cannot imitate this. Okay. This has come naturally for that devotee by being absorbed in Krishna. So similarly, if we start becoming absorbed in Krishna, we will also become humble, because not because we are becoming great or something, but the light of Krishna's glories is so much that our smallness will get ignored and we'll just focus on Krishna only. So these all exalted devotees, when they talk about their expression of humility, that is because their complete absorption. Immensely they are absorbed in the glories of Krishna and how much they have received from Krishna. But when we are practicing as a sadhaka, in general, our consciousness will be, I am doing so much to Krishna, what Krishna is doing to me. So in that way, sometimes we think. And most of the times, you know, when we are starting, when we are the beginners, we will see if we get some material benefits, then only we will say like, you know, bhakti is working. Okay. So this is our material consciousness, which will see like material advancement. If I'm getting, then that is a sign of advancement in my getting the mercy from Krishna. But when we talk about the exalted devotees, they will see like, you know, Krishna has done so many things to me. I am doing nothing to Krishna. So this way the devotee thinks. And the final part, when we're talking about, you know, serving Krishna with respect to Krishna, this humility, the suppression of talent is not the cure for pride. Okay. So the purification of intent is the cure for the pride. So what I mean by this, sometimes, you know, it may happen with you or it may have happened with someone. So sometimes we don't exhibit our talent because we think by exhibiting that talent, we might become proud. Okay. So what I'll do is I will not exhibit that talent because that talent exhibition will bring me pride. So actually by saying this, we are saying that we are humble now and we will become proud later. So this statement itself is saying that we are proud. You are understanding? If I'm saying that, you know, if I do something, then I'll become proud. So that is the reason I'm not doing it. We are thinking that now we are humble and if I do something, I'll become proud. But actually saying this itself is the sign of pride because pride is not something which will come from outside. We all have pride in our heart. Because of that, we will not become humble. Even little bit exhibition of our talent will bring us so much of pride. So that pride is not coming from outside. It is coming from inside. So when Krishna talks about where the lust lies, he says, Indriyani mana buddhi. So lust is there in senses, intelligence and mind. So when we see the sense objects, so the lust actually triggers from inside. So that time we cannot blame the object because it's like when you shoot a rifle, okay, if the bullet is there inside, then only the person will get killed, no? If there is no bullet, then you just shoot, still the person won't die. So the problem is not with the sense objects. The problem is inside us, the lust is there. That is why it is triggering. So similarly, today we might not have, you know, exhibition of pride because the opportunity is not there. But whenever such opportunity comes, then our pride will come up. And that is the reason how we can actually cure this pride by serving Krishna, by using all our talents in Krishna. If you sing well, then you have to sing for Krishna. If you do some service well, let us say cooking well, you should cook for Krishna. If you are good at something, you should start doing it for Krishna. Because of that, the purification will happen. And then only when you exhibit your talent, the pride won't come. Humility will come. So most of the times we think like, you know, if we perform very nicely, I might get proud. Yes, that will be there because pride is, you know, lying in our heart. But when we start serving Krishna with whatever talent we have, we will actually get purified. So when we get purified, what will happen? Even if we do something, we will consider it as the mercy of Krishna. So we will see in the light of the greatness of Krishna, not as our greatness. So when we start seeing like this, when we start respecting each other, and when we start, you know, killing our expectation of honor and all, so what will happen is we'll become humbler. And it is very interesting that the grass, the blade of grass is being used as an example. So humbler than the blade of grass. So in one of the lectures, His Grace Shubha Krishna Das Prabhu says that, you know, why the blade of grass is used to compare us? Because the blade of grass knows that it is the blade of grass. But we doesn't know who we are, right? We are actually the servants of Krishna, even the servants of Krishna. But we think as the masters. So the blade of grass thinks that it is blade of grass, but we are not thinking who we are. That is why we have to be humbler than that because it is more knowledgeable than us. So that is the reason this blade of grass is being used. So I'll try to summarize whatever I spoke so that we can have any question or comment. I'll try to share the screen. Okay. So we have started with where the text 2 ends, that with the misfortune that I don't have taste. And text 3 ends with one can have taste for the chanting. We have not covered the part of tolerance yet. we will cover it in the next time. And we have spoke about the meaning and cultivation of humility from the scriptural perspective and practical perspective. And we have used the definition which is given in the 13.8-12 by Srila Prabhupada, that humility means one should not be anxious to have the satisfaction of being honored by others. So it is not saying one should not be honored, but it is that we are not craving for the honor. And then we have understood what is mana, dambha, amanitvam, and adambitvam. And we have also learned that we should not let our ego interfere with our purpose. We have taken the example of Srila Prabhupada, where he was not honored as a sadhu, but still he has continued because he had a purpose to serve. And then we have told about, we are not, you know, rejecting the honor. We accept it, but we don't expect it. And we have shared this into the three areas. One is with respect to service. So as a preacher, don't decide based on where I will get respect. He will execute the order of his authority. And the focus is on where can I do my service best. That is the focus. It is not where can I get the respect most. And then we spoke about how self-pity is not humility. So always talking low about ourselves is also self-absorption. So either we are talking about how great we are, or we are talking about how waste we are, or how poor we are. So in both the cases, either self-congratulatory way or self-condemning way, we are only absorbed in ourselves. We are not absorbed in Krishna. So what humility does, it actually gives us the launching pad. So it is the launching pad to freedom from the self-absorption. Unless we are out of our self-absorption, then we cannot be able to absorb in Krishna. And that is the reason today why we are not able to chant properly, because we are absorbed in ourself. If we are absorbed in Krishna, then definitely the taste will start coming. And then we will be able to chant 24 hours. Kirtaniyaha Sadahari. And also we spoke about with respect to Krishna, that the cure for pride is not suppression of talent, but purification of intent through service. So we will utilize all our services into Krishna consciousness to serve Guru and Vaishnavas. And because of that, our talents will also get purified. And when we exhibit our talents, the pride won't come. The humility will come out. And finally, actually, higher taste, this is something which I have not shared. So in general, we have learned in 2.59 that when the higher taste comes, only lower taste goes. So today, why we are not humble, or we don't perform, we don't exhibit humility, because we enjoy pride. Okay. So in the Gopi Gita, they say like, Krishna, with your smile, with your sweet smile, the pride in the hearts of the devotees will get destroyed. So here what is happening, they are getting so higher taste in Krishna's smile that they feel like, you know, the enjoyment in pride is nothing. So here sometimes we are not able to humble because we are enjoying the pride. So when we start absorbing into the glories of Krishna, when absorption in Krishna happens immensely, what will happen is we will lose the taste for enjoying ourselves into the pride. But when we don't have the taste, what will happen? We will start enjoying the pride. And that is the reason we are not able to become humble. So in this way, we can actually develop humility, and we can be humble in our situation, and we can start choosing our services and performing our services in a humble way. And with this, what will happen? Purification will happen. And with that purification, this taste will start manifesting. And with that taste, what we'll do? We'll do Kirtaniyaha Sadahari. So this is some part of the text 3. And about tolerance, we will talk in the next session. So Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Shiksha Ashtakam ki jai, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu ki jai. Thank you everyone. Any comments or questions? I have taken more time.
So nicely explained, cover almost all the points from Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam, Chaitanya Charitamritam by taking different examples, Prabhu. Very loud Hari Bol to you, Prabhu. I request thank all the participants loudly said Hari Bol to Sri Ashwa. Hari Bol.
Hari Bol, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.
Hari Bol.
Hari Bol.
Yes, so
I request all the devotees, if you have any questions, please raise your hand. And after that, please unmute. Those who want to speak, you can speak. Okay, Hare Krishna. Leelashri Mataji, you want to say something, Mataji? Please unmute and talk.
Yes, Prabhuji, I want to add one point.
Yes, Mataji.
Prabhuji, in the higher text and lower text, it's like the story of Srila Prabhupada when Prabhupada when he was keeping in the place when he established a small ISKCON, he kept and posted that keeping on the head like a hand and saying that he will get more higher taste. And the people were living the lower taste, which will give them non-permanently the taste. But when they joined the ISKCON, they got the higher taste. And the second one I want to say, Prabhuji, that over-boasting or non-boasting will not be tolerant to the people. Because once a man who got leg fracture, he was saying that I want a qualified doctor. Then all doctor was coming and saying, I'm qualified. But he was not allowing. At last, one doctor came and said that, okay, I study in that college. I came from this college. Like that, he said all the things what he did. Then the man said, you came to treat me, right? Why are you saying this much? I don't want you. But he's saying that I want to make you faith that I am qualified. But he said no. So it won't be, means it people won't tolerant if we means overboast me at them.
Yeah, very nice, Mataji. Thank you for sharing.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna. Yes, any question or comment?
Prabhu, one nice comment in chat box. Can I read?
Yes, Prabhu.
One second, Prabhu. Kirtika Mataji, message in chat box. Amazing, very polite, humble explanation about humbleness, Prabhu.
Thank you so much, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
I'm Sethuram, Prabhu. I could relate your preaching with my daily work. Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu. Thank you.
Venkat Prabhu, if you have any question, you can please unmute and ask.
Yeah. Thank you, Prabhuji. So, Prabhuji, very nice class.
Thank you, Prabhu.
I had a question while you are explaining all this. So,
yes, Prabhu.
Yes, whatever you said about humility and all is, that is very relevant when we are in service, when we are in the Krishna conscious world, right? And
yes,
once
Prabhu.
We come out of that and we have our day job, we are in corporate world and all that. So there you, if you're humble and you don't expect anything, you just, the problem is we have to transform it to a different world when we are going there. And again, when we once we come back to the Krishna conscious world, we want it to be relating to what we discussed, right? So it
yes.
is a fight between those two things. And that's how
yes.
I think the purification is getting stopped or it is not progressing as we are expecting. So
yes, Prabhu.
How to balance this?
Yeah. Very true, Prabhu. Actually, if everyone has understood Venkat Prabhu's question, he's saying like, you know, what we are talking here is most relevant when we are into the environment of Krishna consciousness, when we are in the association of devotees. But when we go out, it is, you know, it becomes very difficult to implement these teachings because that world is very dynamic and very hostile, actually. Because if we become humble, then people may trample on us. So it will become difficult. And after that particular material exposure, when we come back here, so this shift is becoming difficult, right? And that is something which every one of us face. So, but actually, somewhere we don't understand the things in a proper way. That is the reason the implementation gets stuck. Because even if we have learned so many things, like from the last 30 minutes, I might have spoken about so many things, but all the things may not be relevant today. Right away. So we have to choose which is the one thing or two things I can pick up and implement in my real world in a safe way. For example, let us take about the point that humility means we will not let our ego come in between our purpose. So similarly, when we are working in our office or business, we have a purpose why we are working over there, why we are going over there. So sometimes people may come up and start pulling our leg or may start talking negative about us, may start provoking our ego. So that time we should remember, oh, in that class, I have understood that let not my ego come in between my purpose. Okay, so what I'll do is whatever they are trying to provoke my ego, I will not act to that and I'll just focus on my work. And sometimes, you know, this is one learning. And the second time is when you're trying to perform in your office, maybe your superiors may not be interested to acknowledge you, because most of the superiors think if I acknowledge him, he might expect some increment and all, or he might get, you know, full cup. You know, in general, we use this word, full cup. So he will become proud and he will not perform later. So they have their own insecurities to handle. And that is the reason they might not respect or acknowledge or give the, you know, respective honor that we actually deserve it. So because of that, we should not reduce our productivity, because even if we are working in a job as an employee, we need not work as an employee. We can still work as an owner, because the attitude that we are going to develop today, that will actually reflect in our future also. So similarly, all these learnings, we may not be able to implement directly in this world, but definitely there are two or three things you can find out which are easily implementable. And once you start doing that, you will also find opportunities to implement others also. So in this way, you have to create a balance that we go, we know most of the times what happens is we try to implement everything that we learned. So that won't happen. You know, you have to pick up one thing according to your psychophysical nature and your the environment which you are working on, which is implementable. Today I have spoke about, like, till today, text one, text two, and text three. Three texts we have spoken, right? This text three half only. So out of all this, you might have, you know, two or three learnings only which are very relevant to you. So start implementing that. And over a period of time, you'll get more things which are looking like implementable. Like this, you can go on. Does this answer your question, Prabhuji?
Yes, Prabhuji, yeah, I think, yeah, it answered. But yeah, as you said, implementing that,
yeah,
is a little difficult, but yeah, we should at least make an attempt.
Yeah, we should make them, because no one is doing it, Prabhuji. Actually, in the material world, you will be one out of millions who would be doing this. So how it will be?
You're lonely and that.
That is why, the, you know, in the devotion, A, B, C, D, A starts with association. We are not putting chanting also on the first. We are putting association, because we know that, you know, we are alone in the material world, but we are together when we come to this Krishna consciousness. That is the reason these classes are very important. This association will feel us that, you know, we are not the aliens, because outside people are seeing us like that only. Hey, yaar, tu Hare Krishna ja ke bahut badal gaya. You are not doing this. You are not eating this. You are talking different jargon.
Very true, Prabhuji. That's why even though the whatever whole week we are doing, at least this two days of association is also helping us to reset and again,
yes,
not forget what we should be doing and continue for the next week. Yeah, that is definitely helping you.
Yes, 100%.
Yes. Thank you, Prabhuji, for that.
Thank you.